Again, I would like to bring you greetings from the North American Division. It has been a delight to be a part of this great encampment to my brothers and sisters in the great Alberta Conference. I've been delighted and excited and inspired to be a part of this encampment with you. Thank your president, Elder Hodder, and his team for the invitation to be here. And also would like to thank them for the theme that they have selected. Stronger Together. What a great focus and what a great emphasis of time to reflect on how we can be stronger, how we can do it together, and that really we can't be stronger unless we find a way to leverage our strengths together and move forward the mission of God. So thank you for the invitation. It has been a pleasure to be here with you. I know God has blessed you as a result of this encampment all week. And now as we bring it to a close on this weekend, I know God will continue to bless us. I'm going to invite you to bow your heads with me as we pray and as we seek God's guidance and His Spirit to be with us as we go into the message for today. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for the privilege and opportunity to be a part of your family. We thank you, Lord, for this encampment. We thank you for the many messages that have gone out and that have been received. We thank you for the inspiration that we have received. Now, Lord, as we bring to a close this encampment with this message tonight, we ask that you might hide the preacher behind the cross of Calvary, that we may not see him or hear him, but we might see Jesus high and lifted up. And Jesus said, if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto me. So, Lord, draw us closer to your throne of grace today. Give us that we need. And when we leave this meeting, when we leave this space, when we leave this time, may we leave rejoicing, saying it was good to have been in the house of the Lord. So, Lord, we pray and we thank you in advance for what you are going to do and speak to us from your message this evening is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Our message is entitled, Some on Boards and Some on Broken Pieces. It is taken from the book of Acts, chapter 27, and it is really the entire chapter. So I'm going to pick different pieces and parts of chapter 27 that we'll reflect on. But it is a story, and it's familiar to some of us and not so familiar to others. But it is a story of Paul that is, I think, an exciting and very interesting and very vibrant story. But more than that, is not just a story about Paul, but it's a story about the God that Paul served and how God delivered and how God will still deliver. Our theme again, Stronger Together. And we see that theme in this passage of Scripture. And if you have your Bibles or your devices, I invite you to take them and turn there with me. And we will start reading in verse 27. And the Bible says, Now when much time was spent and when sailing was now dangerous because the fast was now already past, Paul admonished them and said unto them, Sirs, I perceive that this voyage will be with hurt and much damage, not only of the lading and the ship, but also of our lives. Nevertheless, the centurion believe the master and the owner of the ship more than those things which were spoken by Paul. And I want you to know that they're in a ship now and they're transporting prisoners on the ship to take them to a particular place. Paul was a prisoner. They were headed to Rome. And they were, as they're on this ship, they encounter a storm on the ship. And they had to make some decisions. And Paul told them, listen, we probably need to just stay where we are, but these men, these were sailors, these were men of the sea, these were Roman soldiers. They were accustomed to these types of storms. They were accustomed to these type of situations. And they said to themselves, we don't need to listen to a prisoner to tell us what to do. Paul said, listen, it's dangerous as we move ahead. Let us not go ahead. Why don't we just spend the time here until the storms and the winter time passes, because it's dangerous as we go ahead. But they said, you know, Paul can't tell us what to do. We have sailed these seas before. We understand what the seas bring. We understand that there are storms. We have battled these storms before. We understand how to navigate our way through. And so we're not going to listen to a prisoner, let alone a preacher prisoner. Paul doesn't know what he's doing. He doesn't know what he's saying. Paul is not a sailor. We are the sailors. And so we don't have to listen to what Paul has to say. And so they moved forward and they kept going. And sure enough, they did run into what Paul had warned them that they would run into as they continued to sail. And it's very interesting as we watch and listen and read how the story continues to unfold. God had given them a message through his servant Paul. God even warns them that their lives could possibly be lost through the message that Paul delivered to them, but they didn't listen at all and they didn't hear it all. And it sounds much like people are today, that you can tell them this is what God said, you can tell them this is what's going to happen, you can tell them the storms are coming, and you can tell them everything, but they discount it and they throw it away and they say, you don't know what you're talking about. We know better how to conduct our lives. We know better how to live, and we know better how to navigate the situations of life. So you all can't tell us what to do. You church folks can't tell us. Preachers can't tell us. Pastors can't tell us. We're going to do what we think is the best thing to do. And that's what they did. You see, God has called Paul to warn the people, and God has called us to warn the people. And sometimes, even though we warn them, they won't listen. And so we find that happening here in this particular story. And so they get to a point, and I'm going to advance a little bit. I'm not going to read all the scriptures, but let's advance to verse 22. Well, let me go start with verse 21. It says, but after long abstinence, Paul stood forth in the midst of them and said, sirs, well, let's start with verse 20. You want to get verse 20. And when neither sun nor stars in many days appeared and no small tempest lay on us, all hope that we should be saved was then taken away. Now, remember, Paul had told them the storm was coming. You're sailing right into a storm. Let's just camp here in this particular place, because that will help us be protected from what the storms of the seas are. And so they said, well, we're going to go ahead. And they go ahead and they try everything and they go days after day after day, even up to 14 days, and they are totally lost at sea. And the sea now is, the winds of the sea is blowing them at will. And here in verse 20, we pick up that story, and it says, when neither sun nor stars in many days appeared, and no small tempest lay on us, all hope that we should be saved was then taken away. So now, after 14 days of doing it their way, after 14 days of fighting the storm, after 14 days of trying everything that they knew that was opposed to work, and everything that had worked in the past, after 14 days, they've given up. And in fact, the Bible just said in verse 20, they had given themselves. Not only had they given up their thought of getting through the storm, they said, listen, not only are we going to not make it through the storm, this storm is going to take our lives. That's what verse 20 says. And now, you know, it's interesting that God had warned them, and while they went on their way, Paul just took a back seat. And the Bible says he reappears in verse 21, but after long abstinence, Paul stood forth in the midst of them and said, sirs, ye should have hearkened unto me and not have loosed from Crete and to have gained this harm and loss. Now I exhort you. Now I love this. I love this verse 22. Now, understand, Paul had tried to get them to do what God had told Paul they needed to do, and they ignored him. They discounted him. They said, you don't know what you're talking about. We're going to do what we're going to do, and we're going to sail the way we want to sail. And they got in trouble. But I am so glad today, I'm so glad to say to you today that God doesn't leave us to suffer the consequences of our decisions by ourselves, even when we go against what God told us to do. So here comes Paul, and Paul says now in verse 22, now I exhort you to be of good cheer, for there shall be no loss of any man's life among you, but of the ship. In other words, Paul is saying, listen, God has shown me that he will deliver us. He will keep us. He will save us. Now, the ship is going to be lost, but the people are going to be saved. I wish somebody would say amen. He said, listen, the vehicle is going to be lost, but God is going to find a way in spite of the fact that you all went against what God said, went against the direction. He said, listen, there will be some consequences because the ship is going to be lost and all the cargo is going to be lost and all your valuables on the ship are going to be lost and everything's going to be lost on the ship, but the lives are going to be saved. For there stood, the Bible says in verse 23, by me this night, this is Paul speaking now, the angel of God whose I am and whom I serve, saying, fear not, Paul, thou must be brought before Caesar, and lo, God hath given thee all them that sail with thee. Now look what the Bible is saying. Paul said, listen, this is what the Lord told me. The Lord told me that this ship is going to be lost, but you are going to be saved because I have a message for you to deliver. I have an assignment for you to do. And the assignment is to go and stand before Caesar. So no matter how bad things look, and no matter how much the storm is raging, and no matter how much the people that it seem to be, they have your lives in their hands. He said, God is saying, Paul, your lives are not in the hands of the sailor of the ship. Your lives are in the hands of the God that you serve. And in spite of the circumstances, and in spite of it looks like you are going to go down, he said, listen, Paul, I am going to save you because I have a job for you to do in Rome. I want you to appear before Caesar. And he said, not only am I going to save you, he said, I'm going to save all the lives that are there with you. Isn't that something about God? And he gives Paul this assurance, and Paul now passes this assurance on to the sailors and to the Roman soldiers. He said, don't be afraid, be of good cheer, because God has showed me we're going to be all right. The ship is going to go down, but the people will be saved. And so the Bible talks about, in verse 27 and verse 28, that the men found out that the ship had now gotten close to running aground. And Paul is saying to them, he said, listen, you all have been fighting this storm for 14 days and have eating next to nothing. He said, so here's the plan. Now, the theme that we've been talking about all week is that we're stronger together. Here's the plan. The plan is, first, everybody eat something. He said, listen, now understand, this is amazing. This is amazing. Understand, these men have given up hope of survival, hope that the storm is going to let them go. They had given up hope of anything, that their lives were going to be taken, the ship was going to be wrecked, everything was going to go, and the storm is still tossing the ship around in the sea. And Paul says, I have a plan. God has given me a plan. Listen, everybody, just don't worry about the ship. Go and get something to eat, because you all been fasting for almost 14 days. He said, first of all, get something to eat. Put some nutrients in your body. Get some strength in your body, because you've been weakened during the 14 days of battling the storm. And the Bible tells us in verse 34, he says, take some meat, verse 34, for this is for your health, for there shall not, listen to this, for there shall not an hair fall from the head of any of you. Oh, I wish I was there. I wish I was there. I wish I was there when they declared this. He said, listen, not only will you not lose your life, Paul said, not one hair shall fall from your head, because the God that I serve will deliver you with no harm coming to anybody. And then the Bible says, and when he had thus spoken, he took bread and gave thanks to God in the presence of them all. And when he had broken it, he began to eat. Then were they, in verse 36, all of good cheer, and they also took some meat. And when we were all in the ship, 316 souls, in other words, 276 people aboard. And then the Bible says, in verse 41, and falling into place where two seas met, They ran the ship aground, and the foreparts stuck fast and remained unmovable, verse 41, but the hinder part was broken with the violence of the waves, and the soldiers' counsel was to kill the prisoners, lest any of them should swim out and escape. But the centurion, willing to save Paul, kept them from their purpose and commanded that they which could swim could cast themselves first into the sea and get into the land. Now, one of the things that happened in verse 38 through 40, these sailors, they saw that the ship was in trouble. And so what they were going to do, they had a lifeboat on hand, but it wasn't enough. There weren't enough boats for everyone. And so the sailors, those who were in charge of the lives on the big ship, the sailors said, we're going to take the lifeboat and we're going to act like we're dropping anchor. But instead of dropping anchor, we're going to drop the lifeboat and we're going to be saved and just leave this ship to its demise. Paul, understanding and heard what they were doing, went to the captain, went to the centurion and said, listen, these guys are planning on leaving. He said, listen, I told you that the God that I serve said that everybody's going to be saved except the ship will be lost. But if we don't stay together, then all will be lost. I wish somebody was listening to me today. That's a message for the church. And what Paul is saying to them, if these sailors escape and leave the rest of us behind, then the plan that God gave me is not going to work. The only way the plan God gave me is that everybody's got to follow the plan. Everybody has to stay together. Everybody has to do the same in this plan. And so the centurion said, okay, and he told the boys to go and cut the lifeboat and let it fall into the sea. And they cut the lifeboat and let it fall into the sea. And then they said, okay, if the lifeboat is gone, then the only way we're going to make it. And see, they had gotten a ship close to a place where the ship, they were afraid the ship was going to run aground. And Paul said, they said, listen, if it's going to run aground, we might as well all just jump overboard right here in the middle of the sea, every man for himself, and let us try to make it the best way we can. And so, but before we do that, because we're afraid, and that's what verse 42 is talking about, we're afraid that if we do that and we let the prisoners go, and if the prisoners escape and they make it to land, then we are going to be held responsible and responsible even to the point of our own lives. So they said, before we jump and swim to ashore, at least try to swim, they said, let's kill the prisoners. But the centurion wanted to save the life of Paul. And he said, listen, no, we're not going to do that. He said, we're not going to do that. No one's going to be killed. The centurion said, willing to save Paul, kept them from their purpose, the Bible says, and commanded that they which could swim should cast themselves first into the sea and get to the land. Now, I want you to see what the Bible is saying here. This is beautiful. He says, listen, Roman soldiers were trained to know how to swim. That was a part of their training. So all the soldiers knew how to swim. But the problem with that plan, even for the soldiers, is that they had become weakened during the fight of the storm. Some of them had become injured during the fight of the storm. And so their injury or their weakened condition would not allow some of them the strength and the ability to be able to fight through the stormy waters to get to shore. And so the centurion said, here's the plan. This is the plan. Remember, Paul said that God had told him that everybody, if we stay together, see, we're strong together. If we stay together, if we stay here on the ship, in spite of the fact that the ship looks like it's about to sink, the ship looks like it's not going to make it. He said, but if we, the plan is, Paul said, the plan from God is to stay together, because we're stronger staying together than we are splitting apart. He said, if we stay together, we can have a plan. God said, Paul says, God has a plan that everybody can be saved. So the centurion said, here, part A of the plan. Those that can swim, in verse 43, cast yourselves first into the sea to get to the land. Now, I want you to understand what happened before they made this command. Remember, they were in this boat and in the ship, and they were trying to make it home. So what they found where two seas came together, two rivers came together, and they were, and this place was more shallow than where the sea was. And Paul instructed them to take the ship and run the ship aground. Have you ever been on a boat and the boat, the water was too shallow and the ground kind of was just below the surface of the water and the ship comes aground? That just happened to me on a vacation just a couple of weeks ago where we ran the ship, we ran the boat aground. We weren't trying to do it, but the land, the water was more shallow. And so Paul said, there's a shallow place. If we take the ship and run it full force, let's bank the ship into the ground. And even though there's still water there, there's land there also just beneath the water line. And so they rowed the ship into the ground. But in doing so, the ship broke apart in the hinder part. And that's what the Bible is saying. So that parts of the ship, the hinder part of the ship broke in pieces and planks and in pieces. And God knows what he's doing. And so after they ran the ship aground, the centurion said, those of you who can swim, throw yourselves overboard and do your best to make it to dry land. He said, those of you who can't swim, because we now run the ship aground, and because the ship being run aground and we ran it aground at a fast speed, the ship now has broken into pieces. And so those of you who can't swim, I want you to find a plank from the brokenness of the ship and get on that plank, float on that plank, kick as hard as you can till you can get to dry land. He said, some of you, it may not be enough broken boards. There may not be enough boards big enough for you to float on. He said, some of you just find some broken pieces of the ship. If you find some broken pieces of the ship, then just hold on to that broken piece of the ship. It will keep you afloat in the water. Kick as hard as you can, and you can get to dry land. And so what I love about what Paul is doing, and I love about what God is doing, God says, listen, all of you are at different points. Some of you are strong enough and able enough to swim with the gift that God has given you to get to dry land. He says, so you all get out the boat and swim. And some of you are injured and in a weakened state. You might need to get a plank and swim to dry land. And some of you can't even get to a plank. He said, if you can't get to a plank, just find a broken piece of the ship. And if you find a broken piece of the ship, get to dry land. And I'm here to tell you, my brothers and sisters, we may be at different places in our journey. Some of us may be strong enough to swim. Some of us may be strong enough to find a plank. And some of us may just have a broken piece. And no matter, you know, the object of the game, the object of the story, the object of the situation is not how you get to the shore, but that you get to the shore. And some of us may spend too much time on how we get from to the heavenly shore instead of focusing on the fact of getting to the heavenly shore. And so here God makes provisions for all of the different family, for those who are strong enough to swim, those who can find a plank big enough to float, and then those who may just have to find a broken piece and let the broken piece get you to dry land. I wish somebody was listening to me today. I don't know where you are in your own journey. Some people say, you know, the old ship of Zion, will it make it? The ship of Zion, it's not about the ship making it, it's about you making it, and it's about me making it. And God says, I have made provisions for everybody who wants to be saved to be saved. And Paul says, not a hair on your head will be touched. He said, everybody, even the prisoners, even the Roman soldiers, even the sailors who first disobeyed what God says do, God says, I've made provisions for everybody to be saved, but we have to stay together. We have to stay strong. We have to follow the plan of God. And God says the plan is big enough and broad enough for everybody to be saved. I talk to people sometimes, they get frustrated with the church and they say the church is, you know, you have hypocrites in it, and the church does have hypocrites in it. Jesus had hypocrites when he was here. And if Jesus had hypocrites when he was here, then the hypocrites gonna still be here until he comes back. And it's not till he comes back and takes us home when he get rid of all the hypocrites. And people say, well, I'm not gonna stay in the church because there are hypocrites in the church. And it reminds me of a story that some of you have heard me tell about a friend of mine flying in the sky. He was flying in an airplane, and the airplane began to fall out of the sky. And he said they lost altitude. They were flying at about 35,000 feet, and they dropped from 35 to 30, from 30 to 25 to 25. To 20, he said, and the people were hysterical. People were hollering and crying on the plane. The flight attendants didn't know what to do. They said the plane was reeling and rocking back and forth, and no one believed that they was going to make it out of that situation alive. And I asked them this question. I said, while you all were in that frantic position, while you were in that frantic state, how many people went to the door of the plane, opened the door, and jumped out? And he said to me, he said, listen, nobody did. He said, we were afraid. We weren't crazy. I said, so I guess you guys must have concluded, as bad as things had gotten on the plane, even though we're not sure the plane is going to make it safely, we're not sure with it falling out of the sky, now some 15,000 feet, They must have concluded on that plane, every passenger must have concluded, that as bad as things are on the plane, it's a whole lot better on the plane than it is out of the plane. So we have a better chance of making it to our destination safely if we stay on the plane, even though this plane seemed to be in trouble, even though the plane, we're not sure is going to make it. But if we're going to make it, we're going to make it staying on the plane. And I'm here to tell you, my brothers and sisters, as bad as the church may appear to be, and as weak as it may appear to be, it's a whole lot better in the church than it is out of the church. And you got a whole lot better chance of making it to our destination that we call heaven in the church than you do outside the church. So stay in the church, the old ship of Zion. And as the church may fall away, but God says, my objective is not to save the church. My objective is to save you. And even though we may lose the ship, God says, I'm going to save you. I made provision to save everybody. You might have to swim. You may have to get a plank, a board, the Bible calls it. Some on boards and some on broken pieces. But just find you a broken piece and hold on to that broken piece of the old ship of Zion. And you will make it safely to your destination. Some say, you know, you might be fortunate enough, you may be strong enough and empowered by the grace of God to swim to the heavenly shore of the promised land. Some may have been fortunate enough to get a board that's big enough and buoyant enough to help you make it. You may have been buoyed by your life experience and your understanding of God, and your knowledge of his work and your walk with him and your faith in his word. And let me tell you, my brothers and sisters, the destination is not prophecy. It is not the 2300-day prophecy. It is a means to get to the destination. The destination is heaven. The destination is not doctrine. It is a means to get to the destination. The destination is heaven. The destination is not the health message. It is a means to get to the destination, because the destination is heaven. The destination is not how I dress and how I look. It's a means to get to the destination, because the destination is heaven. Some of us may have just to grab a broken piece. Not much. And I may not be able to swim like Paul or Peter or James or John. I may not be fortunate enough to grab a board like the prodigal son or like Philip or Doubting Thomas or Andrew. But surely if I can't swim, somebody help me today. If I can't grab a board, surely, surely, surely I can find a broken piece and I can grab on to that broken piece like Samson did with my last dying breath. You know, Samson, one of those stories in the Bible of Samson, it doesn't look like he had a glorious ending to his life, because he messed up with the woman. He messed up in his life. He messed up with going against what God told him. He messed up with Delilah. He messed up with telling the secret. He messed up, and it looked like his life didn't end with a glorious bang. But the Bible tells us, when I look over in the book of Hebrews chapter 11, and it mentioned the heroes of faith, Samson is mentioned in the heroes of faith with Moses and Elijah, who may have been able to swim to the shore or get a plank to the shore. Samson said, I just held on to a broken piece and I made it safely in. Or you may be like the thief on the cross who died on the cross. His life is at an end. His life had been a mess. His life had been an embarrassment to his family and to his parents and to his community. But on the cross, on his dying day, on the last hours of his life, he said to Jesus, he reached out and he got a broken piece. He said, I'm going to hold on to this broken piece. He said, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus said to him, I say unto you today, thou shalt be with me in paradise. He held on to a broken piece. And all we have to do, my brothers and sisters, is hold on to those broken pieces. That may be all we can hold on to. You might have been an alcoholic or messed up your life on crack or some other drugs, or God is saying, grab on to a broken piece of the ship of Zion. You might be an adulterer, shacking up with someone who is not your husband or your wife. God is saying, though your sins be as scarlet, I will make them white as snow. You may be the biggest liar around town. The Lord says, I will take your crooked tongue and make it speak words of truth. You might have children all over town by men and women or who are not your husband or your wife, but God says, grab on to a broken piece. I will make you brand new and will give you safely, get you safely to the heavenly shore. You see, my brothers and sisters, for God, it's not about how you get there. The journey to it. We spend a lot of time focusing in on the journey. And my journey is better than your journey, and your life is worse than my life. God is immensely concerned about reaching the destination. And so God may have to take different ones of us on different journeys, because what God is concerned about is one thing and one thing only, and that is to get us to the heavenly shore. And he said, you might be strong enough that you can swim. You may need a plank, or you may just need a broken piece. You can't hardly swim at all, and you're just flapping in the water. God said, that's all right as long as you make it to the heavenly shore. That's what God is mostly concerned about. It's the destination. And he said, you have the best chance if you stay together and grow from each other and learn from each other and pray for each other and lean on each other. That's the best chance you have of making it to the heavenly shore. I think about my brother Travis, and I often tell his story. We raised in the same house, from the same parents, went to the same schools in the same period of time. We were just 3 years apart. Travis' life went one way, my life went another. And Travis did everything he was big enough to do. Went against every rule, every way my mom and dad raised him. We had the same mother and father. We lived in the same house at the same time. We had the same rules. But Travis' journey took a different path than my journey. But the God that I serve, was just as interested in Travis's journey as he was in my journey. And God was trying, God, two sons, same parents, same God, two journeys, but God says one destination. I'm just as interested in Travis, who's been out there drinking and alcoholing and drugging and robbing and shooting people and doing all those things. God said, I'm just as interested in Travis as I am in Alex, who's gone to church and who's went to school and studying to be a minister. God says, I have no favorites. I don't favor Alex over Travis or Travis over Alex. God says, I'm trying to save both men. And maybe one of them can swim to shore. And maybe one of them, I need to put them on a plank, or maybe I need to give them a broken piece. But God says, I'm immensely interested in getting both men to the shore. And they have to take different paths and different journeys. But God says, I am the one that's guiding the journey of each man. And I'm trying to do the same for each person. And yes, this one may not listen over here. And guess what? Alex got his problems just like Travis has his problems. Travis's problems are more public, and Alex's problems are more private. And God said, I got to deal with Travis, and I got to deal with Alex. You see what I'm doing with Travis because you see his public problems. You may not be able to see as much what I'm doing with Alex, but I'm working on Alex just as much as I'm working on Travis. My mother praying for both sons. Never stop praying. Lord, save my boys. My mother prayed that prayer for decades. It seemed like on the outside, oh, the prayer for Alex is working. Oh, we see him. He's a pastor. He's a leader in the church. But Travis, still smoking, still drinking, still robbing banks and everything he could rob. Oh, prayer's not working. Don't you be so quick to judge what God is doing. You can only judge what you're seeing. But you can't judge where it counts. Where it really counts to God is what you can't see. And what you can't see is the journey that God has taken both men on, how it's impacting their hearts. To Alex, it looks like, oh, it's having a good impact. To Travis, it looks like it's not having any impact at all. Only God. God said, man looks on the outward appearance, God looks at the heart. After decades of praying, we started seeing, after four decades, almost five decades, we started seeing some changes in Travis. He'd been in and out of jail, in and out of prison. And my mother noticed the change, and she said, Travis, you know, I see some change happening to you. You know, you need to start going to church. You know, that's what our first thing. God says, listen, you don't know that in his heart, he may already be going to church. And so Travis told my mother this. He said, Mama, you don't know what's going on. And he said it respectfully. He said, Mama, you don't know what's going on between me and my God. And Travis kept on. And several months passed by. You see Travis' life started changing. He wasn't in jail and wasn't drinking and wasn't drunk. What's going on? And finally, one weekend, I was coming to town. Travis called me. He knew I was coming to town. He said, I understand you're coming to baptize our nephew. He said, I was calling to see if you would mind baptizing me. And I'm floored because I didn't see it coming. And I said, well, yeah, Travis. And I thought very quickly about it. We got off the phone and I thought about it. I said, Travis is living with someone who's not his wife. I said, I got to call him back. So I called him back not 10 minutes later. And he laughed when I called him back because he knew what I was calling for. He busted out and said, I said, I was wondering when you're going to ask me. I said, ask you what? He said, I know what you called for. And before I could ask the question, because Travis was raised right, he knew what the right thing was. He said, I talked to this young lady. And I told her I was going to get baptized. But I told her once I get baptized, I couldn't keep living the way I was living. And so I asked her, would she mind us getting married? And she was floored. She said, would I mind? I thought you would never ask. And so he said, would you, while you're, when you come to baptize me next weekend, would you mind marrying us? I said, oh, yes, Travis, I'll marry you. I said, but let's do it in the right order. We're going to marry you, then we're going to baptize you. So by the time you get home that night, you're all good in the eyes of the Lord. And I baptized Travis. And Travis' life, even before I baptized him, his life was immensely changed. He went around to all the family members, said, I'm sorry, listen, I know I used to cuss you out, and I know I'd said some bad things, I know I haven't been a good example, I'm sorry. Travis would even go to the stores, places he had been months ago, and cursed people out, went and found the manager, and say, listen, I'm sorry. I'm sorry for what I've done, but my life has changed now. And Travis's life impacted my family unlike my life ever have. To the point that some of my nephews who were following in the same path that Travis had been following in, they came to me and said, Uncle Alex, whatever that happened to Travis, I want that to happen to me. Will you baptize me? Will you marry me and my live-in girlfriend? Travis' life had that impact on them, not my life. Because God is immensely interested in a destination. We get too caught up in the journey and not aware that God is working and changing and moving and shaping the lives of people in the journey. 2 years after he was baptized, Travis found out he had cancer. Never knew any indication of it. And almost 2.5 years to the day that I baptized Travis, I was standing over his casket saying, dust to dust and ashes to ashes. But I was standing, tears going down my face, amazed at the God that we serve. Because everybody was looking at my life and saying my life was this and that life, and looking at Travis' life and saying his life was less than. And I want you to tell you, my brothers and sisters, in the eyes of God, no life is less than. We're all equal at the foot of the cross. And God is equally trying to save everybody. Maybe this one on this journey and this one on this journey. And there's no doubt in my mind, no question in my mind that Travis made his election and his calling. Sure, his life testified of it. The power of the transforming grace of a loving God. And what I told my mother during the funeral, I said, Mama, God did with Travis what God needed to do with Travis to get Travis to the heavenly shore. And guess what? God said about Alex, I'm still working on Alex. I'm trying to get him there now, but I got Travis there. I'm still working on Alex. God says it doesn't matter if you can swim to the shore or you can get on a plank and get to the shore or you have to grab onto a broken piece like Travis grabbed onto a broken piece. God says the main thing that's important to me is that you make it to the heavenly shore. Not how you get there, but that you make it. And God says, I'm going to do everything in my power. I'm going to try. And that's why sometimes with them, God put them in a situation that all hope was lost. Everything that they knew to try to do right to get out of their situation, God just put them in a situation that all hope was lost. And it was only in that situation that they turned to God. God is immensely more concerned about our destination than he is about our journey. We're strong and together trying to get to that destination, praying for each other and encouraging each other and receiving inspiration from each other. I receive inspiration when I When I think about my brother Travis and the story of his life and the impact of his life, and I say, if the Lord can do that for Travis, maybe he can do something for Alex. If he can get Travis to the heavenly shore, maybe I'm going to make it too. And I know that I can. And I know that God will not rest until he does everything that he can so that I can make it to the heavenly shore. Let us pray. Father in heaven, I thank you for your amazing grace. I thank you for the fact that you never give up on us. And even when appearances, outward appearances, may indicate that we're far from you, we really never know because we don't see the inside of what your impact is on the hearts of men and women. And so, Lord, help us to stay on the ship. Help us to stay together and receive inspiration and encouragement from one another, because it's only in that space and only in that place do we have the best chance of making it into the kingdom, getting to the heavenly shore. Maybe some can swim, maybe others on planks, and maybe some just on broken pieces, the broken pieces of their own lives, but they're holding on to that hope, to that promise. And if they keep holding on, they'll make it to the heavenly shore. There may be someone here today, under the sound of my voice, who need to make a commitment that I want to give my life to Jesus. And I want to make it to that heavenly shore. And I may not be able to swim like the pastors and the elders. I may not be as strong as the deacons that I can get the plank, but just let me hold on to a broken piece. And my brothers, my sisters, I'm just looking for a broken piece. I don't care how I get there. I just want to get there. And God says, I've made all provisions possible, every provision possible for you to make it into the kingdom and to arrive safely on the heavenly shore. Thank you, Lord, for hearing us. And thank you for answering our prayer. And thank you for your faithfulness to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.